Hey guys, this is David Kwan, and welcome to another hour of Kwanminism. Since my last name is Kwan, and this video, I will be talking about an hour about different sort of topics. Yesterday, I did my very first video of this type, talking for an hour about different topics without editing any of it and just going for it. First time doing it. Looking back, like I don't think I did a horrible job. As it wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. So, I mean, that's my personal opinion. You can tell me how horrible that was or whatever have you. But yeah, I think this could definitely be a thing. Maybe an hour might be a little bit too much for me at times. So, you know, because maybe I don't have enough topic to talk about, or maybe I don't have enough, one topic is not that big enough to talk about for that long. Yesterday I had some really great topics, I think. I think the topic on North Korea and the tensions there, that was a humongously loaded topic. So I just had a great time just talking about that and sharing my thoughts on that. So it really depends on the topics, I think. And today, doing this, being in this mode where I'm like, I'm going to do this like every weekday. I'm doing my daily things, and every time I'm just like, all right, what am I going to talk about at the end of the day? What topics are there for me to talk about? So I'm always just scouring for news, and I'm going to different news sites and reading stuff. So that's actually been beneficial for me to just dive into this thing. It makes me have a really deep appreciation for people who do this for as their job. You know, reporters who have their news cycles where they have to report on different things. Even comedy people like Jon Stewart and Stephen Colbert, the fact that they can do this, it's pretty remarkable and amazing, because you have to be so, I mean, they have writers and stuff. This is just me doing all my stuff, so there's that. But even so, like, you still have to be in the know of all these topics that are happening around the world and around United States and around the topics that you want to focus on. You have to be up to date on those things, and that's not easy when you have this busy lifestyle, which I don't, which is why this is possible for me to do right now and easy to do. Anyway, with that said, let's get started on the topics. As you can notice, as long as you're not watching this video like right after I uploaded it, there will be links right here. Each of the link is a section, a topic that I'm going to be talking about this video. You can click on the link and skip right to a topic that you want to talk about. But also interested in hearing me talk about whatever, what have you. Or you can just hear me talk for an hour. Or you can just exit and never come back to this channel again. All up to you, really. That's why I give you options, you know. Options are great, right? Anyway, first topic. So this topic hits home for me. This is a U.S. news topic. And it's recently, I think it was either yesterday or 2 days ago, tragedy struck the family of Rick Warren. Rick Warren is the influential Christian evangelical pastor who leads Saddleback Church. He's actually had a pretty influential impact on my life as well, because as a teenager, my dad's a pastor. And I, for the longest time since I turned, up till I was 17, I thought I had a calling, from God to do Christian work as I grew up. Like, people would ask me, what do you want to be when you grow up? My answer was usually like, oh, I want to be a missionary, or I want to be a pastor, like, who continues God's work. So, like, when I was 16 or 17, around there, I was deeply into, you know, doing devotional with Rick Warren's book that he authored, The Purpose-Driven Life. So even to me, Rick Warren had a pretty impactful life, impactful influence to me. He had a big impact on my life, is what I want to say. That saying that was so hard. I don't even know why. I'm not a very eloquent guy, as you can see. That's why this talking for an hour is probably helping me be a better speaker. In any case, he's a very influential guy. By this point, you can pretty much consider him a very public figure, and he's very vocal too. It's unusual for I think it's hard to find comparisons. Other evangelical pastors who really talk a lot about get involved in politics. Rick Warren definitely got involved in the political world. He even did an inauguration speech for Obama or one of the other. I don't remember which president it was, but he was involved in that. So he is this public figure. In a way, he's also a political figure. So we can, and his views are widely known. I mean, he is a traditional evangelical Christian. I don't know what denomination it is. I feel like it's Baptist. You guys can look it up. You guys will know that. I will know after I do this video, of course. I'll fact check myself, and maybe if I'm not feeling lazy enough, maybe I'll put it in there like, oh no, I was totally wrong. It was actually not Baptist. It was Methodist or whatever. But yeah, Rick Warren, evangelical pastor, his views are totally what you would expect out of a traditional evangelical Christian, against abortion, against gay marriage, you know, pretty typical. But politics aside, tragedy has struck Rick Warren's family's home, and it really strikes home to me as well. Like, I can feel that pain myself simply because I am a pastor's son myself. And just imagining what that would mean for my parents would just be, oh my gosh, it just, you know, it really like tugs at my heart just thinking about that scenario. So recently, a day ago, Rick Warren's son, Matthew Warren, committed suicide. And from what I didn't know about this, but apparently for a very long time, Matthew Warren suffered from mental health issue of depression. A lot of great doctors were, you know, he saw a lot of great doctors. He had great medical care, a lot of counseling done, but in the end, he couldn't cope with his depression and ended up killing himself. Really tragic. I really feel for the guy, and really feel for Matthew Warren and for Rick Warren. It's one horrible thing to happen to a family, and I've never experienced it myself. I don't know anyone in my family who committed suicide, and it hasn't happened. So in that regards, it doesn't hit home, but it's easy for me to imagine that happening, because my family is, you know, kind of a similar thing. My dad's a pastor, my mom's a nurse, and although, you know, my dad's beliefs and my beliefs are, you know, really different now, by this point, my dad and I disagree on almost everything. But even so, it's my relationship between my dad and I are still something that's, we're still family, you know. It's weird, but I still have his voice in the back of my head whenever I do anything. And that voice is telling me, like, what are you doing? Are you doing this right? Like, are you going to make me proud? So I'm still doing things as best as I can because I want to please my, you know, I want to make my dad proud and stuff. And sadly, most of the time that's not going to happen because our views are pretty different. We disagree on almost everything. So it's going to be really hard to, you know, meet my dad's expectations. Just recently, I was, you know, fundraising for a gay civil rights organization. My dad, just like Rick Warren, views homosexuality as a sin. So I don't know how I'm going to make my dad proud by doing that thing. But at the same time, it's a tie between my dad and me. He was my greatest role model and hero for the longest time. It's not an easy tie to just break like that. I still love him. He still loves me. I still do everything I can to respect him. So knowing that, being in this family, it is to me really heartbreaking to learn about what happened in the Rick Warren household. And I know there's probably much more important things going on in the United States right now, but that's really what brought me, made me consider this story. And it's really unfortunate, the part that's really kind of saddening and really also maddening is the response that Rick Warren is getting from his really historical opponents, not opponents, but people who didn't like his views, because he does have a view where, you know, he doesn't think gay marriage should be legalized. He's against abortion, the typical social issues that a typical evangelical Christian minister would, the views that he would have. Of course, you know, those views would be conflicting against these whole groups of people. But because we live in an age where it's the age of the internet, people on Twitter, Facebook, blog posts, anywhere can get on there and just spout their opinions about whoever and whatever, and still maintain the sense of anonymity, they can go on there and kind of still attack Rick Warren or talk really badly about him in this situation. And it's, I don't really think it, it's, to me, it's really unfortunate. And this is why, like, I was watching a Fox News piece on this, and I was just like, you know, I normally don't agree with almost everything on Fox News, but on this, it's just like, it's, I can't help but feel to agree that it's, this is not right. But at the same time, you can't do anything to stop that. You can't do anything to prevent that, other than just tell people that, like, that's not the right thing to do. Rick Warren is a public figure, and as a public figure, that kind of thing is just the nature of things. If I was a big public figure, and my view of, you know, because I support gay marriage, and I'm, you know, that is a divisive issue. There are a lot of people out there who would disagree that gay marriage should be allowed. So there are, of course, going to be a lot of people who hate me. So if it was me, if I was a public figure and I had that view and I had that opposition, and maybe I have a son, if I have a son and he commits suicide, then I'm pretty sure, you know, I'm gonna have the same situation like Rick Warren. People are gonna go, you know, message me on Twitter and or you know, respond to a news about my tragedy, and just start talking about how I deserved it, and how my views, you know, should teach me better. Like, this situation should teach me better to change my views. Things like that. Things like personally attacking me. I would expect that. It's unfortunate. It's sad. But it's going to be out there. But really, honestly, I disagree with politics aside, social opinions aside, you know, this man's son died. Give him a break, man. Give him a break. My heart goes out to this guy. Like, he's not, you know, his views may be off, but this is what he believes in. And he does the things that he believes in. And you can kind of see that in his actions too. Rick Warren is not the, to me, I don't get the sense that he's like this religious charlatan that other people might view him to be. Rick Warren to me is a genuine guy. He does what he believes in. He doesn't take any salary from the Saddleback Church, which he leads, and a great percentage. Somebody said 90%. I don't know if that's true, but a great percentage of the income that he gets from the books he wrote, which is a huge amount of money. He sold 30 million copies of *The Purpose Driven Life*. Great chunk of that he gives it away to the poor and to the charity organization. So, you know, maybe the guy has views that you don't agree with, but you know, like I said, this guy, his son just died. Give him a break. People are people, no matter how much you disagree with the guy. That's all I'm gonna say. And even if he was this guy who was like just your view of this evil guy, it's kind of wrong to just kind of personally attack someone just because you don't agree with the person. Especially at a time when that person is going through this tragic moment in his life. So, that's my thoughts on that. Second topic that I'll go to is a world news event. It's an interesting story that I turned into CNN. The reason I think it's interesting has more to do with how it's reported than the topic itself. But It's also a tragic news. So this is a CNN news piece. The title is, the link is, will be in the video description. It's the U.S. diplomats died doing what she loved in Afghanistan. So in Afghanistan, there was a suicide bombing. There was a convoy, and somebody, there was a terrorist who did committed suicide by the bombing thing. I don't know how to say that. Suicide bombing? Yeah, I guess somebody did committed suicide bombing. Four people died, I think. And one of them was a U.S. diplomat. And the CNN news piece focuses on this U.S. diplomat. It's really tragic, you know, and it sounds like she was there risking her neck out to kind of just help out different communities in Afghanistan. Reason she was in the convoy because she was trying to deliver books to schools, books in Afghanistan language. So for, you know, students in Afghanistan, like elementary school or something like that. So she was doing humanitarian work in Afghanistan, and it's really unfortunate that this happened to her. And the CNN news piece just pretty much focuses on her, which makes sense. She was just the only U.S. diplomat killed. She does seem like a really awesome person, and it's just really sad that, you know, this happened, and that she was there to trying to do her best in things. So I don't have any ill will towards the U.S. diplomat who is, and I don't know if I'm going to pronounce her name right, but it's Anne Smadinghoff. And she graduated from Johns Hopkins University with an international relations degree or a concentration, and served in all over the world, in Caracas, Venezuela, and she ended up volunteering in an embassy in Kabul, and that's why she ended up among the dead. So, tragic. But it's really interesting that the CNN piece just exclusively decides to just focuses on her. It doesn't tell you much. The news piece doesn't say much about the other people who died or anything. So it is one of those pieces that kind of is a sob story in a way. It's not informative, but it evokes emotions like, hey, you know, there's still stuff going on in Afghanistan. There's still Americans in Afghanistan. I guess that's really the point of the story. I don't know, but I thought it was interesting that the CNN news piece was just like, this awful thing happened, and this is her story. And then that's pretty much the news piece. Again, it's definitely sad. I really do admire this U.S. diplomat, Miss Smadinghoff, if I'm saying her name right. I think it's tragic. Definitely she had such a future to look onto, and doing the things she loved. It's really great. Admire her for it. Really would like to know about the other people who died as well, but, you know, I guess this CNN news piece will not tell you that. So that's interesting that this piece will only focuses on Anne Smadinghoff. So that's the bias of the CNN news piece there. Okay, so those are the two topics. I'll go to the next topic now. I feel like I want to say more about... I don't know what to say, though. That's pretty much my opinions on the whole thing. I don't have any deeper analysis beyond that. Pretty being simple there. So tell me what you think about that if you do have any more deeper analysis. The link of that article, the CNN news piece, is in the video description. If you decide to check it out and you have a further analysis that you have that you want to bring it up, go for it. If you want to know about what I think and then you want to ask me a question, go for that too. I'm totally fine with that, but I think I'm done talking about that topic. The next topic is, I was reading in Joystick, and that it seems like Sony, so this is now entertainment news, in the gaming world of things. Sony is becoming a lot more, trying to be more, trying to foster a more friendly environment to independent developers or small budget independent developers. I know back, way back, I think like either 2 or 3 years back, or maybe it's even more recent, but they started this called something called Pub Fund, where they would put down $20 million or something to that amount, and that $20 million would go towards making sure that they support independent developers and games, so that games like what were some of the games that, but like small games that so they can have them on PlayStation Network and something like that. So that was really cool. Currently, they're really pushing Guacamelee and Blacklight Retribution and different small independent downloadable games, which I think is awesome. And I think this is something that these console companies like Microsoft and Sony need to do more of. And when I was actually thinking about, you know, independent gaming landscape, in the console landscape of things, I was thinking this is exactly what they need to do in order to really thrive in the next generation, in the generation of PlayStation 4 and whatever the next Xbox calls itself, and the Wii U or whatever the next thing that Nintendo comes up with. And the PC landscape is already there, kind of, with Steam, and I guess Origin is a different thing, but there's a lot of different digital markets on there. But with on the PC side of things, there is a great little niche market for independent developers and stuff. But I really feel like the console market has a lot to learn from a marketplace like the App Store on the iPhone. And I feel like if they don't do that, they're going to fail next generation or just really struggle. This, because next generation, the expenditure of gaming, the cost of gaming is going to go up so significantly. It's the focus is so much on graphics, but hardly anyone can keep up with the cost of that. It's becoming so much more expensive to make games. And the payoff really is not that big as it was before. The jump from PS2 to PS3 was a significantly big jump, and we could notice that difference pretty much right away when the first Xbox 360 game was kind of shown, you know, Ghost Recon, Advanced Warfighter. We were just like, wow, this is what the next generation looks like. And everyone was just like amazed and just floored away, and jaws were dropped. You know, it was such a world of difference from SD to HD. Our jump now is not as big. So far, the next generation games we've been able to kind of, we were previewed to see, were just things like Watch Dogs, Star Wars 1313, which is now, I don't know if that's going to be canceled now. I don't know what the deal is, but we've seen it. We've seen the power behind that. So, and we've seen the Unreal 4 engine kind of demonstrated, the new Square Enix engine demonstrated. We've seen some tidbits of the next Killzone game, Killzone Shadowfall, Battlefield 4 just was shown off. So graphically, holy crap, like, amazing looking, but the jump is not that big, because right now, the best graphics that we have is still damn good. You know, Crysis 3 on awesome PC, amazing stuff. The difference between Crysis 3 and Battlefield 4 right now, or the difference between Battlefield 3 and Battlefield 4 right now, is just like, yeah, Battlefield 4 looks pretty awesome, but the jump is not that big. So the payoff is not that big, is my point. I think it's coming to the point where better and better graphics isn't cutting it. Gaming needs to become much more creative and much more friendly to consumers who are, you know, now starting to adopt all different kinds of ways to buy games and play games, free-to-play games, cheaper market models, downloadable games. The market has become more varied now, and I think consoles start need to, the next generation consoles are going to start needing to adapt and to that, so that the developers and the publishers who can't keep up with the rising cost in development, because only very few are going to be able to keep up. It's the big ones, you know. Of course, EA is going to continue with development of things like, you know, Battlefield and what else do they have? And you know, sports games and Mass Effects and all that. And Activision is going to go with this Call of Duty, and Crytek has his Crysis games, and Ubisoft has his Far Cry and Assassin's Creed. The big games will be able to manage with the big expenses of games, but the middle tier developers are going to really struggle. And for them to be able to, you know, do well, and for the low tier developers to do well on the next generation, I feel like both Microsoft, all of them, all consoles need something like the App Store, where you can buy a game real cheap or for free. And maybe some have microtransaction models, but done really well. There's really great models out there on the App Store, maybe even on the Android Store, and just kind of these games where you can just pick up and play, and because there's a lot of creativity in these games. I feel like I've seen recently, I've experienced much more creativity on my phone than on the computer or on a gaming platform. So I really feel like that creativity needs to be there on PlayStation 4 or the next Xbox or the Wii U or whatever the next you know, Nintendo console is going to be there, in order for the next generation to thrive. So that's my opinion. I'm pretty sure a lot of you guys are going to disagree, but that's my opinions. If you do disagree, tell me what you think on the comment below. And since I don't really get that many comments, I tend to respond to pretty much every comment I get, as long as I feel like I can respond well, or I have something worthy to say. So that's that. Fourth topic is, as I promised you yesterday, I can finally talk about rape in this video. Yay! Rape talk. Really don't have. It's odd because I don't have too much to say on it, other than, you know, it's pretty bad, but it's interesting to see the prevalence of something like discussion of something like rape culture, and it's kind of disheartening because I once went to this forum, and it's a Christian forum, and I was just shocked at the forum. So it picks up the Bible verse, it discusses the Bible verse where it talks about, it's in Deuteronomy. Forgot the chapter and verse, but the verse pretty much says, hey, if a man rapes a virgin, you know, a woman who hasn't had sex before, who wasn't married, then that woman must marry the rapist, if the father permits. If the father doesn't permit this, then the rapist must pay the man 50 shekels, or something like that. So this is a Christian forum. The discussion is centered around this verse. And the discussion is just like, holy crap, what am I reading right now? This is horrible thing that they're writing and discussing. Because they're justifying the verse. And some of the justification is like, okay, I understand the historical nature of it, but, you know, now you're jumping from historical justification to why we need to have this verse be relevant in our modern society, and that's where the jump becomes icky, and just wow, like I can't believe people are saying these things on a forum. So just justification is, in that historical time, a virgin losing their virginity is like a death sentence for a woman, and they're totally shunned in that society. It's so in that society, it would be better for a person to be dead than to be a virgin, and it would feel like that, and that's why. In some cases, is that what it would actually be considered to be a generous thing for a virgin to marry the rapist, and therefore be a wife rather than a virgin whose virginity was totally violated. So that's like the historical perspective. That's just like, okay, this is not like that horrible thing that this biblical law is proposing. It's actually much more generous than having a woman whose virginity was violated to live like that and be shunned by society. Okay, so in that historical society, you know, that Israelites were in, fine, that's understandable, maybe can be justified in those times in that society. But, like, and then there are all these comments like, you know, and this is a verse that needs to be taught to every single kid living right now, because it teaches you the value of chastity, it teaches you the value of not looking like a whore, and then acting like, well, why was I raped? Well, it's because you dress like that. This is where the discussion is leading. Like, people has to, it was just like, wow, these Christians writing these things on these forums is, I had no word to say. My reaction was just like, the whole time, I was just shocked. So that makes me think, like, do I really have to ask this rhetorical question? The rhetorical question is, imagine a scenario, right? This, I don't know, let's say a 16-year-old girl. You know what, all right, let's make her legal. This 18-year-old girl. She goes to this party wearing really scantily clad clothes, like really spaghetti strap and tank top that almost acts like a bra with like a belly button flop. And like a really, really short skirt, okay? So she looks really provocative. She goes to a party wearing that. She gets super drunk at the party and passes out, maybe. I don't know, but maybe she doesn't pass out. But she gets super drunk, and this guy ends up taking advantage of her in the party. And she ends up, you know, she ends up getting violated, if you will. Or that person has sex, even though she's kind of like, doesn't want to, but she's powerless because she's drunk and passed out and whatever. So I would consider that rape. So she gets raped, she wakes up, and, you know, whatever. That situation, who's to blame? Who's at fault? And what was wrong in that picture? That's the rhetorical question. It's rhetorical because the answer is super easy and should be obvious, but I feel like if I asked this question in that Christian forum, it'd be like, oh, that girl learned her lesson. She shouldn't have been, you know, she shouldn't have drank that much. She shouldn't have gone to a party wearing that. And that kind of answer just scares me, because the right answer, this is a rhetorical question, the right answer, who's at fault? The rapist. Always the rapist. Like, why do you blame anything else? No matter what the situation is, that person, that whoever the rapist was, raped this girl. It doesn't matter what she was wearing. It doesn't matter how intoxicated she was. This person raped this girl. End of period. It's not even a discussion. It's just a totally rhetorical question. For all I know, a girl could come in naked into my room and pass out right in front of me. And if I decide to just take advantage of that and have sex with her right there, I mean, well, she's trespassing my property there, so I guess that would be her fault. But if I decide to just have sex with her right now, right here, who's at fault? About the rape thing, it would be me. I'll be the rapist. Like, this is not even, you know, shouldn't be a discussion. That's the end of there. That's that. You know, that's what really just boggled my mind when I came up in this Christian forum and just reading this, and it's like, which is like, wow, I can't believe they're justifying that someone should be raped just because of the clothes that person is wearing, or just because of what that person was, you know, doing. Wow. So that's my pretty simple rant there. It's an interest, like, it's on that note, it's like, it's pretty simple in most cases, you know. But rape is one of those things that is is so detrimental. I feel like in a lot of societies, even in America, I think, rape is detrimental not for the rapist, but for the rape victim. And that's really wrong, and that's really unfortunate. And they're really blamed, they're shamed, they have a stigma attached to them afterwards, and some become pregnant afterwards, and they have to deal with that. If they go through with an abortion, they go through with even more shaming, even more stigma, and might even be estranged from the entire family member who doesn't believe in abortion and believes she did the wrong thing. And so there's this family conflict. Some people become homeless because their parents will kick them out because they conducted an abortion. Horrible, right? So that's one thing. If they don't and have this baby, now they're raising a child who was born because a rapist raped her. I mean, can you imagine the emotional toil of that? The emotional pain and the burden of that. It's horrible. And on top of that, you know, that's you know, if you're raising that child, great. You know, that's one thing. But there's bound to be people who know how that child came to be, and still there's stigma attached. So it's just considering that is awful. So who the victim, like the person we should always blame, no matter what the case, you know, is the rapist. The rapist is the person to blame. Why are we blaming the victim? It doesn't make any sense. How most societies have this backwards. And it's just frustrating, and it's really maddening that this goes on. And in some countries, there are laws that make it so that the rape victim are punished, but the rapist goes away scot-free. The Bible, for example, that Deuteronomy law, it's what's mind-blowing to me is, yeah, in that historical society, it could have been more generous for a woman to be married to, get married to the rapist than to be a virgin whose virginity was violated. I understand that, but you consider the biblical law in modern day, with modern day morality, and it's just irks the hell out of me. Like, okay, the father has the power to permit whether this is allowed or not. So already that is a patriarchal, sexist society that the Bible is promoting. Which is just awful in itself. But here's the thing. So the Bible says if a virgin is raped, the father has the power to permit, the father of the daughter that was raped, the father has the power to permit whether this rapist can marry her or not. Okay, so if the father permits, they become a married couple. There is no stigma anymore about her virginity being violated, and they live happily ever after, or so we imagine. If the father doesn't permit, the rapist pays the father 50 shekels of 50 currency or coin or whatever, and that's it. Like I said, I feel like I mentioned this in another video. It's like, imagine, like if there was a rapist out there who was filthy rich. Like, it's just like, oh yeah, I raped your daughter, by the way. I'm really sorry. Here's 50 coins. Okay, bye. And then next day, oh yeah, there's another person. I raped your daughter, by the way. I'm really rich, though. Here's 50 coins. Have a good day. It's just like, I know that's a wrong way to interpret this biblical law, but if you look at the face value of this biblical law, that's possible. You know, it's just like a rapist gets away simply by paying his way out of it, and there's no mention of how to comfort or how to really take care of the rape victim, who I'm assuming now has so much pain and burden because of the fact that she was raped. So many societies have this backwards. We need to really consider and be mindful of people who underwent rape, and it's such a high prevalence. I feel like the statistics, I don't know, I need to look this up, but it's a pretty, like, I think it's like 1 in 3 or 1 in 4 women in America, or just in Western society overall, experience rape at least once in their life. That's just ridiculous. I recently learned that my friend was recently, you know, it was date rape, but it's just like, god dang, it's unbelievable statistics that's still possible and that's still happening. And it's awful that every time that happens, instead of, you know, comforting the victim, instead of trying to find justice, we end up justifying the rape itself. We end up blaming the rape victim, which is just awful and horrible. So that's my rant on that. Last topic. Today, the one productive thing I did today, I went to the office of New York Cares. New York Cares is this nonprofit organization that links people who want to volunteer with, you know, the volunteer projects and stuff. But before being able to volunteer, they have to go to an orientation, and that's what I had to do today. I went to this orientation and learned a great deal about New York Cares. It's a pretty powerful organization, and I love the way it models itself. It's become so big now that there are New York Cares utilized, like New York Cares has 50,000 volunteers just in New York City, which is amazing. It's been such a successful model that it's training people in other cities to come up, you know, to follow this model in their cities and other states. So there's now 200 partners in other cities who are doing this New York Cares model. Amazing stuff. I'm really excited to start volunteering, being connected with New York Cares. It really values, you know, flexibility and accountability, doing things, volunteering as a group and not sending up people on their own. And respecting their time commitments and things like that sounds really great. One moment that I want to kind of pick out was that made me think back to my volunteering experiences was in the beginning of the orientation or near the beginning, the speaker kind of just asked a question and was just like, okay, I'm going to ask you guys a question, and if the answer is yes, then stand up. It's just asking about your volunteer experiences. So first he's like, have you guys ever volunteered before? And I was just like, I stood up. Have you guys volunteered helping children before? Stood up. Have you guys volunteered, you know, to serve elderly senior citizens before? Stood up. Have you guys volunteered in a school before? Stood up. Like, it was amazing. Like, I didn't realize that I volunteered a lot. I always feel like I haven't had much, like, experiences. I mean, I certainly don't have my resume doesn't look that great, you know, I don't have an expensive work experience or whatever, but it's just like, man, I did a lot of volunteering. That's really interesting. And I was volunteering I think the beginning of my volunteering experience was in high school. I think it was my senior year, 12th grade or 11th grade, one of those years, I decided to have an elective community service course. That was an interesting course. I was just like, oh, this is available. I totally want to take this course. And that course, of course, it's a school course. I don't know if I can consider that as volunteering. But I did more volunteering in high school, too. That was just one thing. I went to a local elementary school. At the very last period, my eighth period, I believe. I went there on my eighth period, and I met up with fourth grade teachers. And I was basically like a teacher's assistant. On Fridays, I would play sports with fourth graders, PE, physical education. And on all the other days, I would grade papers grade tests and activities and homework assignments that the kids brought in. I'll just be a teacher's assistant to fourth grade teachers. On Wednesdays, I went to the school's library and helped out the school librarian. So 5 days a week, it was my elective to go to this local elementary school and just help out. Like, one of my classes in high school, one of it was to volunteer at an elementary school. So I feel like that was an interesting foray into the volunteering world. Also, my mom is a nurse, was a nurse at the time, in this hospital, and she linked me to this volunteer opportunity where I went to the hospital once a week or so, and I played violin to people who underwent surgery, so they're in pain. So I guess my mom was like, you should, you know, come volunteer and comfort them by playing music. So I play violin to people in surgery. So that's why I stood up when that person said, have you volunteered in the hospital before? That was my volunteering experience. And after I played violin, it would be dinner time. And during dinner time, I would, you know, help serve trays to people in their hospital beds. So that was one experience I did. And then in college, most of my other volunteering experiences have been regarding, like, just tutoring kids. Grace Church School was a place in New York City that I went to, like, every weekend. And I was, like, a tutor teacher or volunteer teacher to... I helped a class, like, this teacher taught third grade or fourth grade, whatever. I think I was, one of the assistants during when she taught. And then afterwards, I would be assigned to these two students who had tutor. So I had that volunteering done. The senior citizen, the elderly volunteering, I definitely have done. Gosh, what? I can't quite remember, but I've definitely done it. I mean, even besides from volunteering, like, just nonprofit work. That was one thing that was interesting, because one of the questions was, just like, are you working in a nonprofit organization? And I couldn't stand up. And I was just like, I used to. But, like, I couldn't stand up for that. But it's also interesting that I did do that. If you count my internships as volunteering, which I wouldn't consider that volunteering, then I definitely volunteer for the elderly. But yeah, those are some of my volunteering experiences. Most are tutoring, and it related to education. I did a lot of volunteering tutoring, you know. I went to this one organization that was like homework club, after school homework club. I went there and I did various activities with the kids and just helped them with their homework. And when it was dinner time, you know, their parents would come pick them up, and that was pretty much it. And I did that like twice a week, I think. Twice or once a week every Tuesday or Wednesday, I don't know. I think I did the most volunteering as a college student. After college, I didn't do much volunteering after that because I was working or looking for work. And I guess in that sense, looking back, it's a little bit disappointing to me that I wasn't as involved as volunteering after college. I probably should have kept driven myself to work at my job but also volunteer at the same time. But honestly, after college, I didn't do much volunteering at all. And now that's all I'm doing. I'm unemployed and volunteering at HousingWorks. Now that I've done the orientation at New York Cares, I'm definitely going to get more involved in different volunteering opportunities. So that's definitely going to be fun. I've always enjoyed just being out there and doing what I can do to help. And it's less of a burden when I'm not paid for me, because it's just like, you know, there's a back of my mind. It's like, oh, if I screw up, well, I'm not paid for this. Not that I'm saying that that's not saying that I screw up all the time or that like it makes it easier for me to screw up. No, it's just like, it puts me in a more relaxing mode. Like I'm not tensed up. Like I gotta do my best, because otherwise I'm like, I feel like I'm stealing company time or whatever. I don't have that notion when I'm volunteering. I'm just doing because I'm enjoying what I'm doing. I like volunteering. I've always have, ever since I was a high school student. And so I'm glad that I'm able to still really enjoy volunteering and being motivated to do that. So with that said, I'm going to end this hour of Kwamenism. Didn't really do an hour this time, but I think that's okay. I think you guys, you know, I covered 5 topics today. I think that's pretty good. So, all right. So I hope you enjoyed today's hour of communism. And I'm sure now you are more communist than an hour ago. All right, cheers.